to the Lamb of God.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to preach what the Lord has laid upon my heart tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Psalm chapter number 1 tonight. The book of Psalms, chapter number 1, starting in verse number 1 tonight. 1 through 3. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Amen. Haven't been the easiest of weeks. I found that as a pastor, the easy weeks, they're pretty much over with. Amen. But I'll tell you, God is with us every step of the way. Amen. Not just give Him all the praise and all the glory. Amen. Amen. Psalm 1 and verse number 1. Amen. Amen. Once again, so happy to have our sister here tonight. What was your name, sister?
I'm Lisa.
Lisa?
Yes.
Lisa, amen. God bless you. Let's make her feel welcome.
God brought me in here because I've been listening to your Lord's
Heart Ministry, and that's where
I was on my way to. And I was like, I
might
as well just check this one out.
Amen.
And
amen.
God brought me right in here.
Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. So happy to have you here tonight, Lisa.
I like it.
Amen.
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 We love it.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Psalm 1 and verse number 1 tonight. Amen. Amen. I want to preach upon a subject that is really hardly preached about in today's generation, surprisingly. Amen. But it is very important that we grasp a hold of His Word tonight. Amen. Psalm 1, verse number 1 through 3. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Amen. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doth shall prosper. Amen. Hallelujah. With the help of the Holy Ghost tonight, I'd like to preach for a moment or two just upon the subject of the blessing of being planted. Amen. The blessing of being planted. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, once again, come to you in the name of Jesus. I need your anointing tonight, Lord, to deliver such a word. And God, I ask you, Lord, that you would anoint me from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. Lord, anoint my mouth. Anoint my mind tonight, Lord. Every part of this body, anoint it, God. I'm just a vessel, God, that desires to be used by you. Surely this is a word that you have put upon your servant's heart. And Lord, I'm going to deliver what you have said to your church, God. Lord, help us tonight, God. When we leave, let us leave even closer to you than when we came. In Jesus' name, the church said, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's read our text one more time. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. Amen. You know, there is a great blessing to those that allow themselves to become planted in a good Bible-believing church. Amen. I said there is a great blessing that comes upon those that allow themselves to become planted and rooted in a good Bible-believing church. Now listen, there will always be those who minimize or criticize criticize or lessen the importance of being planted and rooted in the local church, but I cannot, as a pastor, allow that to stop me from telling you what thus saith the Lord. It is God's will that His children find a place that is preaching the gospel and they become planted within that local church. They need to be planted where the rivers of God are flowing, planted where the uncompromising word of God is being preached from behind the pulpit. The Bible tells us that those who are planted will bring forth fruit in their season. Can you say amen? The Bible lets us know that their leaves shall not wither, and whatsoever they do, it will prosper. Amen. There are blessings that only belong to those that plant themselves and root themselves in the local church. Amen. I never knew what it was as a child, oh, to move from this place to that place, from this place to that place. I never knew any such a thing. You see, I know a pastor's children. I grew up a pastor's kid, as many of you know. I was part of the furniture of the church. If I was not at church, the church did not look right. I was in that church when I was in my mama's belly. Amen. Mama's up there playing the piano. Here's Pastor William now. I was in that room. I've been in this thing all my life. Amen. But I know of other children that grew up in pastor's home, and their mom and dad uprooted themselves and traveled all over the country in search of the will of God. But sadly, none of their children, mostly none of their children, are in the ministry today. None of them have any concern about the things of God. I'm talking about preacher's kids now. Many of them no longer have any desire for the house of God, and sadly, many of them resent ever growing up in a Christian home. You see, one of the primary causes of them no longer wanting anything to do with God is the fact that their parents never allowed their children to establish roots within that local church. They were too busy moving around, chasing the latest fad. They ran with the excuse that God was calling them somewhere else, but in reality, a little bit of storm came, a little bit of trouble came, and it uprooted them, and it blew them somewhere else. Can you say amen? I know of many Christians who have ran from one place unto another, back to there, and back to another. It's a sad thing to see. They claim to be led by the Holy Ghost, but now their children and their family is a wreck, and they're all running from God. They may have been chasing the will of God, so they thought, but in reality, all they were doing was chasing their children away from the house of God. Why? Because they never allowed them to become rooted in the kingdom of God. Amen. You see, God is never going to tell a person to uproot themselves out of the local church where the Bible is being preached, where the Spirit of God is allowed to move. God won't do such a thing. Hear me tonight. You see, it's one thing to leave a church when the doctrine is wrong. It's one thing to leave a church when there's sin found within the life of that pastor. It's one thing to leave the church because God calls you into the ministry and you go out and begin to do the work of God. But I'm not talking about that tonight. I'm talking about people that purposely uproot themselves all because they are looking for the perfect church, looking for everything to suit them just right. A tailored church, something that fits them perfectly. Oh, you see, they are what Peter called the well without water. 2 Peter 2:17. These are wells without water, clouds that are carried with a tempted, to whom the midst of darkness is reserved forever. Amen. Hear me tonight if you ever heard me before. I know what I'm talking about. I've grown up in the sea. I've seen it all of my life. Hear what God is saying tonight. I was planted successes that I've seen in other people, and I also learn of the failure of other people. This is a message tonight that will protect you from the lies of the enemy. This is a message tonight that will keep you grounded in the faith. This is a message that will keep stability in your life and in the lives of your family. There are blessings that come to those that are planted within the house of the Lord. Can you say amen? I pray when we leave here tonight, we leave saying, I've heard from God. I'm going to obey what thus saith the Lord. Can you say amen? Listen, the first blessing of being planted, the first blessing of being planted in a Bible-believing church is that you will establish roots. Amen. I said the first blessing of being planted in a Bible-believing church is that you will establish roots. Psalm 92, 13 through 14. Those that be planted, say that. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the court.
Driving, I'm acting like I'm pulling over, picking up my girlfriend. Come on, baby, hop on the ride.
when I got older, the same saints that I was planted alongside with were the same saints that prayed me through till God baptized me in the Holy Ghost. I began preaching to those same people I was planted to as a little baby. I began preaching to them. I saw them pray at an altar. I watched them operate in the gifts of the Spirit. And I began to seek after those same spiritual gifts. All nine of them, I wanted every single one of them. You see, after God filled me with the Holy Ghost, I began to pray. 15 years old, I began to play instrument. I began helping. I began cleaning, visiting the sick. All because I was rooted and planted within the house of the Lord. There was never any such thing as family time at the Glasgow Hall. Didn't grow up with such a thing. Family time was sitting on the front. You better have your hands raised or you're going to get a whooping. What were they doing? They were instilling some roots in me, saying, William, you're going to worship God. You're going to praise God. When you get older, God's going to do something great for you. I'll tell you why I'm here. I allow myself to become rooted, planted, grounded within the church of the living God. Then we become rooted and grounded in the church of God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. I was planted as a baby, and after 29 years, I'm still flourishing. I'm just blooming. God's got more fruit coming. Amen. Some of you tonight, you just got little blooms, and you've been all excited. But God said, you stay planted. I got some big fruit coming your way. Come on, church, do you believe it tonight? You got to stay planted. You got to stay grounded in the Word of God. Don't you give up on God. Don't you give up on the church. Don't you give up on the Holy Ghost. First blessing of being planted in the Bible-believing church is that you establish roots. Amen. Roots. You know, I was doing a lawn today. Brother Steve came to my rescue again. I'm going to start calling Brother Steve Brother Superman. He always comes and helps me and builds me. Well, I'll tell you, there's some things today that I was plucking from the ground. It came right on out of the ground. I like those kind of weeds. Amen. There were other weeds. I had to get two hands and I pulled with all I could. And I couldn't get those things out of the ground. So I separated some of the weeds and took a little bit more. I finally got them out. You see, it's a whole lot harder for Satan to get you whenever you got roots. Amen. You see, Satan, he's going to come around. He's going to try to pluck you up. He's going to try to steal, kill, and destroy. But if you're rooted in the Word of God, if you're rooted in the Holy Ghost, if you're rooted in His house, if you're rooted in His sanctuary, let me tell you, He won't be able to pluck you up. Can you say amen? There is a blessing comes to those that allow themselves to be planted. Number two tonight, the second blessing of being planted in a Bible-believing church is that it protects you from false doctrine. Yes, it does. So it protects you from false doctrine. 1 John 4 and verse number 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit. Say that. Believe not every spirit. Amen. That's why it's important to bring our Bibles to church. Amen. That's why it's important to follow along. Amen. Test everything you hear with the scripture. Well, 1 John 4 and 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. Because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Well, we have got to be careful about the teaching we allow ourselves to hear and the doctrines we allow ourselves to sit under. We've got to be careful about what Bible the pastor preaches out of nowadays. Amen. So we've got to be careful about the Bible that the pastor preaches out nowadays. I'll tell you, I used to be a part of the Pentecostal Church of God. They wanted to bring me and my brothers unto a class to tell us how to be pastor, to learn from these people. Well, they said, turn your Bible to, what? I'll just say John 3:16. Let's use that for an example. Turn my Bible over there. As they begin to read, I looked at Derek. I said, what? Where did he tell me to read? I know John 3:16, and that ain't what he's reading. Well, you see, we got to be careful what we allow this year because it'll get down into our spirit. Can you say amen? Well, you see, if it ain't King James Bible, it ain't the Bible. It's a fairy tale. Amen. We've got to get back to the Word of God, the inspired, infallible Word of Almighty God. Well, you see, what does the pastor believe? What does the pastor teach? Does their lifestyle demonstrate a lie of holiness and faithfulness under the things of God? Or does it demonstrate a life of unholiness and a love after the things of this world? Paul told us in 1 Timothy 3:2-7, listen to this. A bishop or a pastor, a bishop must be blameless. Amen. Doesn't mean that you're going to be perfect. You're never going to have fault. But it means that if somebody were to make an accusation against you, you ought to live such a holy life that people in your church would say, no way, not my pastor. I'm talking about living a blameless life. Well, that accuser will come. But let me tell you, that's why we've got to live this blameless life. A bishop then must be blameless. The husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior. That's a big one, good behavior. I was in a bank not too long ago. I saw a man and I thought, man, this guy sure is a jerk. He's mighty rude to this teller over here. When he turned around, I said, that's Pastor so-and-so. Well, you see, a bishop or a pastor must demonstrate good behavior. They must be given to hospitality, aptitude, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, but patient, not brawling, not covetous, one that ruleth his own house well, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how's he going to take care? How shall he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, amen. Got to know what you're preaching. Got to believe what you're preaching. Not a novice. Lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without. What do people on the outside of the wall say about Pastor William? Are susceptible to false doctrine. They hear one doctrinal message on a Sunday morning, go somewhere else Sunday night, and hear an entire different message preached out of an entirely different Bible. Why? Because they're not planted like they should be. You see, I was thinking of an individual a while back. I was talking to them, and the more they talked, I began to think to myself, I think you are crazy. Have you ever talked to somebody like that? You say, I think you're crazy. Oh, you see, brothers and sisters, I thought to myself, you have not been planted like you should. You've seen so much blood, so much bled, so much junk and trash. You can't tell the difference between what's right and what's wrong. He's an individual that looks for the opportunity to uproot himself and his family, to go somewhere else when the newness of the pastor wears off, when the newness of the church wears off. Well, in doing so, he's opened himself up to false doctrine. There's a preacher, some of you know him, I'm not going to mention his name. Nice guy. He doesn't pastor a church, he's just a local preacher. No, he hasn't preached here, so don't let your mind start wondering who this is. Amen. Well, he called me and he said, Brother William, do you remember whenever I was a youth leader at such and such church? Man, I'm kind of saying, Lord help me not get this away. And you came and you preached for my pastor at that time. I said, yeah, brother, I remember. What was he telling me? Hey, I did you a favor when you were 16 years old. Now that you're a pastor, I'm wanting you to do me a favor. Amen. Well, you see, nothing wrong with doing him a favor if he was grounded and planted. But the sad thing is, I see him on Facebook. One day he's in a oneness church. Next day he's in a Trinitarian church. What's the problem? You can't serve God in hell. You can't serve two masters. You've got to serve one and the other. Trinity believes in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Next day he believes that Jesus is the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. He don't know what he believes. And in case you're wondering, it's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Oh, aren't you thankful for the Godhead tonight? Aren't you thankful for the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost? I'm talking about being grounded.
You see, he's an individual that looks for an opportunity to uproot himself. Travel on somewhere else once the weirdness wears off. He said, William, can I come preach for you? And I thought to myself, I really wish I could say yes. I really wish I could say, come on, you help me out. Now I want to help you out. I want to get, you gave me an open door. I want to open up the door for you to preach. But you know what? Holy Ghost dealt with me. He said, son, don't you allow him to preach. He's a nice guy. He loves me. But he's double-minded right now. You know what the Bible says about double-minded people? The double-minded is unstable in all of their ways. Not some of their ways. All of their ways. James 1:8, a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways, because this individual has uprooted himself and his children. He no longer recognizes the real from the fake. He no longer realizes what's real and what is generic. Amen. Being planted in a biblically sound church will protect you from false doctrine. One place that Josiah likes to go to all the time is the donut store in Oildale called Star Donut. He loves to go to that donut store. He likes to go early because they got the sprinkled donuts. Amen. But as I was preparing this message, I don't know what came on me. Holy Ghost put it in my mind. Well, I begin to think about those beautiful glazed donuts, fresh out of the oven. One time I was getting some glazed donuts and they told me, be careful, it's hot. Amen. Don't you tip me like that. I'm going to see how hot that donut is. I put that thing in my mouth, that thing melted. Amen. Well, guess what happened? Oh, I begin to think about it. Rat poison. You ever seen a rat pellet? They sure do look a whole lot like those little sprinkles that they put upon the donut. I'm telling you, there's people that go week after week after week after week sitting under false doctrine that may look good and may look appealing, but let me tell you what they're doing. They're inhaling that false doctrine. They're inhaling that which will destroy their life. Amen. Let me tell you something tonight. It's okay, church. Let me tell you something tonight. Jesus Christ still is the way. He still is the truth. And he still is the right tonight. Can you say amen tonight? Oh, let me tell you. It does not matter what hell throws your way. If you're rooted and planted and you're grounded within his word. If you're grounded in his sanctuary, filling the presence of God, he can't touch you.
Say the last, because there's many blessings.
Amen.
This is the third of tonight's message. Amen. The third blessing of being planted is that it gives you an open door.
Amen.
For ministry. Yes, it does. Amen. Gives you an open door for ministry. Proverbs 22:6 says this: train up a child in the way he should go. And whenever he's old, he will not depart. Third John, not First John, not John, not Second John, Third John, the John that we ignore a lot of times. Third John 1:4, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. No greater joy than a parent can have than to know their children love God and they're walking in truth. Amen. 3 John 1:4. 3 John 1:4. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in the truth. Amen. There is a reason why we have our children in this church do certain jobs. Amen. There's a reason. I'll tell you. We're giving them an open door into the ministry. Amen. Yes. 2 weeks ago, I'll tell you, Seth, you did a great job, buddy. You did. Yes. How old are you, Seth?
12.
Okay, I was going to say you're 13. I called you 11. I called you 13. I never get it right. I'll tell you, 12 years old, teaching the kids. Josiah got out of class and he said, oh, I had so much fun with Brother Seth.
Amen.
He did a great job. Amen. Seth, you did a great job. Amen.
Amen.
My boys, they love you. Love your teaching. Amen.
Amen.
Seth does that projector. Amen. Nathan takes up the offering. Somebody, I've seen sinners come in. Nate goes, prays with them. Tell you, there's ministry opportunities when you're planted in the courts of the Lord.
Yes.
Josiah, if you saw him before church tonight, you wouldn't think he has any ministry. Let me tell you who runs up here and turns the light on. Amen. It's Josiah. Amen. Who brings joy? Josiah does. Baby Kayla, she what?
She dismisses
us. Yes.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Not yet, Kayla. Just amen. She said, amen, amen, amen. I'll tell you. Give them jobs. Why? Because they're the future
of
the church. One day, I may be right here. I may be coming in on my walker. I won't come in walking on my walker. I'm going to come shouting on my walker. I'll come here slowly. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord.
Yes.
I'll come in here, I'll make my way up, and I'll sit right here in the front so I can back Brother Seth up when he's pastoring. Amen.
Yes.
Awesome. Yes. I'll sit right over here when Nathan's up there preaching the gospel.
Yes. Amen.
I'll come when they're still having church outside and I'm 90 years old, can barely take care of myself. I'll be sitting on a chair outside with my hands raised up saying, God, touch this community.
Amen.
Oh, brothers and sisters, I'm talking about being rooted.
Yes.
Not easily plucked up. When you're plucked up, you're blown. Mm-hmm. Wherever the wind takes you, God says, those that are planted, those that are rooted, those that are grounded within the house of the Lord, going to have two side effects. They're going to be fat. Well, it doesn't mean you're just going to be overweight.